What a lovely introduction, guys.
Actually, it's a great story. We both come from Twickenham. That's the rest of the story.
We're going out to Twickenham.
But this is I've got two radios here. I've got this one.
Yeah.
Big handle on back. What's the difference between this and this apart from size?
Let me show you. This one, in fact, has got a modification on the back. You'll see there's a sort of tail hanging out of the back of it. This is the first radio we made. You know, when we first created this thing, we asked our customers, who were, in fact, those people in Africa mainly. Yeah. I discovered early on that there was a great need for this type of apparatus, that the radio was used very, very effectively in a continent of Africa, which is 600 million people. The best way to bring information to people, because there's no electricity, is the use of this radio with batteries.
Right.
But there was a problem. Batteries were horrendously expensive. People were actually bartering their maize and their rice in order to obtain these batteries. And sometimes, well, most times, you couldn't buy them anyway, because where do you buy batteries in the middle of the jungle, if you understand me? And so I had a flashback into time, and I could see myself in 19th century Africa, you know, wearing a pith helmet, you know, with a monocle, a gin and tonic, one of those fly-swatting things. And I was listening to some raunchy number by Dame Nellie Melba on my wind-up gramophone, you know.
Dame Nellie Melba?
You must have her recordings. We have at
Absolutely.
Home.
Absolutely.
Anyway,
without them.
Anyway, I'm thinking if you can make all this noise by dragging a rusty nail around a piece of old Bakelite by winding a handle on the side. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden I'm in real time and I'm thinking, well, if I can actually make this noise by driving a spring, winding up a spring and then perhaps driving a gearbox and a dynamo, it would drive a dynamo, which would drive the radio, I beg your pardon. And so that's exactly what we've got in here. So let me show you what it is. It's a radio.
It's obviously
got
a working model, covered with bits of yellow paint. And
well, that's, you know, it's come straight from the old workshop.
Straight from the old workshop.
It's got a handle on the side here. Now, yeah. Whether we're going to get a noise out of this, I don't know. Because
unlikely in here.
Well,
probably
it's
sealed.
A bit like... oh, there's something, look. It's a bit like a Faraday's cage in here. Let's see if we can make it work. Well, you can hear there's some sort of noises coming out.
That'll be Radio 1.
Oh, probably. What a shame.
So
no, we can't get it in
can't
here.
Get the frequency
you can't because of all
the
equipment.
All this metal round here stops
can
the
explain
things
what this
going
is.
Through. Well, this is quite interesting.
This, is
this
the
thing here. If I stick this up there, you see, you've got yourself a torch.
Oh.
Which
is really useful.
Forgive me. Quite handy if you want to know who you're sleeping with, if you understand me. Perhaps I shouldn't have said that.
I don't think so.
Take him off the set.
But they do say inventors are mad, and we have living proof.
No, there's no truth in it.
I should actually point out, I want to encapsulate Trevor's life very, very quickly. Because there's, I think now very quickly. Because in fact, you were a very good swimmer. We've mentioned swimming a lot on the programme, but you were almost like a stunt swimmer.
Well, yeah, I swam for a living, which is rather a strange way of making a life of oneself. But he started off as a swimmer as a youngster, and then did my military service, became a physical training instructor, and then when I came out, I swam for a living, literally. We used to put a swimming pool up, and I would show off in this thing to try and pull the crowd round. You see, that's how it started. And then they said, well, will you do some water skiing? Yeah, and do you do
how
high
big were
diving
these pools?
Drops? Well, these were very shallow ones initially because I went to an exhibition and I saw one of these pools, and it's one of these things you see now in schools for teaching kiddies to swim. We used to wreck this thing at a show, and then I would literally swimming in it to pull the crowd in to sell swimming pools. But then somebody would say, by the way, you do use an aqualung, don't you, Trevor? So the next thing I find, we're using aqualungs and wetsuits and dry suits. You do water ski, don't you? Oh, yes. You're barefoot? Oh, well, fine. Do some barefoot skiing for us, you see? And you do drops. So they'd camp me up with a wig and a dress or something, and I'd fall off the side of a ship. And it was easy living. Easy,
water stunt
easy.
Man.
Water stunt
water
man.
Stunt man.
I did a circus in Berlin in 1970, an underwater escape act. I was called Ramses II. And they gave me a sarcophagus, and I had to escape from a sarcophagus. They nailed the lid on to put me in chains and all the business. But it was such easy money. It was a breeze.
Don't tell people that. They'll all be trying it. It was really difficult.
Actually, listen, we
never have enough time to talk to people, but I have to mention, the radio has been very, very successful.
Yeah.
Thousands and thousands. Sadly, not produced in this country because British business did not back these radios.
That was the
because
downside.
They said that was the downside. Mm. Big bad move there. 57% of all inventions are British.
You're quite
and
right.
They get made in other countries.
Absolutely.
But now you're working. Tell me in 1 minute. A laptop computer that winds.
Well, I tell you what, this very radio here was used. Yeah. That point, you know, that wire I stuck in the back there for the torch, yeah. I connected that into a computer, and voila, when we wound the handle, it put enough power into the computer for us to use it, wow. Which is absolutely astonishing. So here we are with this very high tech and low tech. This is the latest one I'm very proud of. Yeah. I got this one this morning. This is like our European model. It really is a super. We call it the free play radio. I don't think this one will work either in here. Yeah, but it's got a handle on the back, but it's a much lighter and a much more agreeable looking machine. I think that's super.
You don't get the torch attachment with this one, which is just as well, I suppose.
Yeah. But back to what I was saying to you about...
No, we haven't got enough time.
We haven't got time.
We haven't got time, but
we're
just tell 50, me.
We're making 50,000 a month now.
50,000 a month.
You're making 50...
We're making 50,000 radios a month after 2 years in business.
How... Just in one second, how many years before a wind-up computer?
Well, I should say a year and a half.
Can't beat it, can you? Ladies and gentlemen, inventor Trevor Baylis.